throughout history, men have quested for the Holy Grail. The quest for the Grail may hold its roots in the ancient mystery schools. In the days of ancient Sumerian Egypt, adherents or students may have been given a set of clues and learned specific skills in order to solve mysterious questions. Later, the Greeks and Romans were also seduced by the mysteries. Much of the information taught at the mystery schools may have involved learning secret or hidden knowledge that was to be used with care and discretion. Later orders, such as the Knights Templar, may have learned these mysteries and quested for hidden knowledge themselves. In fact, the name Knights Templar may refer to the map templates they learned of by studying geometry and mathematics. Some of the hidden knowledge may have involved the use of square, hexagonal, or octagonal templates in order to create map projections that would reduce the amount of distortion in the rendering of maps, thus making them more accurate and reliable. Having the skills to make accurate maps would be a huge advantage over those who did not have these skills. This skill would also logically relate to stonemasonry and architecture and other crafts that the Templars were famed for. Think about the Templars using their templates to build temples in order to command the temporal fabric of time. By using the geometry and navigation secrets learned from the ancients, the Templars were capable of decoding any geomantic mysteries that may have been left as lessons of the mystery schools, and indeed may have been capable of creating a few themselves. Later mysteries such as the Rennes-le-Château, the Oak Island Money Pit, the Kensington Runestone, the Virendre Runestone, the Grail Legend of Accokink, Maryland, and Bacon's Vault in Williamsburg, Virginia, may have been inspired by the ancient Grail quests and left for others to decipher and discover for themselves. In this episode of GIS, we're going to explore what may have been a very early Grail quest by the Knights Templar in the 12th century. There's evidence that the Templars used the octagonal shape of the Dome of the Rock itself as a sighting device in their search for the lost Ark of the Covenant and followed it to its southern orientation to a place in Ethiopia that is as lost in time and clouded in the mysteries as any site in Egypt itself. This location also represents an intersection between the southerly line extending from the Dome of the Rock based on its orientation and the southeast orientation of St. Peter's Square at the Vatican. We've previously established how the obelisk at the center of St. Peter's Square in the Vatican and its surrounding windrose markers may be used as a sighting device. Each windrose marker has a primary compass direction inscribed on it. Each of these directions leads to a place on the globe that is significant to the Roman Catholic faith. The easterly orientation, or east windrose marker, creates a line or azimuth that transects from St. Peter's, across the Balkans, and leads directly to the dome of Hagia St. Sophia in Istanbul, Turkey. Hagia St. Sophia is directly adjacent to the Hippodrome of Theodosius, which also contains an Egyptian obelisk similar to the one at St. Peter's. The back azimuth, or opposite direction, to the west leads to Fatima, Portugal, site of the miracles of Fatima in the 1930s. The town of Fatima was named for the daughter of the Prophet Muhammad of the Islamic faith, while Spain was occupied by the Moors. Most amazingly, the east-southeast windrose marker leads directly to the Dome of the Rock in Jerusalem. Not only does this azimuth lead directly to the building of the Dome of the Rock, The line matches the angle of the northeast facet of that octagonal structure. The octagon of the dome of the rock may be in turn used as a sighting device similar to the one at St. Peter's. And we're going to take a look at how the Knights Templar may have used that very building as a sighting device. Now, in other chapters of my book and other videos, I've examined the possibilities of Thomas Jefferson being a Knights Templar strict observance in the United States and using these principles to create personal, quote, personal meridians or ley lines. So this is indeed maybe a tradition that's descended from the Knights Templar all the way to the time of Thomas Jefferson and even the modern days. So let's take a look at the southeast trending line created using the Windrose marker at St. Peter's. Now, due to the way St. Peter's is oriented, it's about 1.39 degrees east of north, or west of north, tilted a little bit. So the southeast directional marker in this setup is 133.61 degrees, and this is a line that goes, excuse me, from the center of the obelisk across the Windrose marker itself. So this creates a line on the globe, this 133.61 degree angle. It transects its way across the Mediterranean Sea, then Africa, including Ethiopia, and meets the Indian Ocean near Mogadishu, Somalia. On its path across Ethiopia, the line transects the environs of Lalibela, Ethiopia, right near the Church of St. George. Lalibela is home to the Ethiopian Orthodox Church that is wholly independent of the Roman Catholic Church. Lalibela is home to a complex of 13 churches that were hewn out of solid rock in the 12th and 13th century. The ruler of that age, Gabre Meskel Lalibela, designed an arrangement of churches that were said to emulate the layout of the Temple Mount and the city of Jerusalem itself. At this point, Jerusalem was occupied by Muslim concerns, making travel there by Christians dangerous, and it had previously been a place of pilgrimage, so these people created an alternate site to serve the same purpose in Ethiopia. The river that runs through Lalibela is even named the River Jordan. The churches are all connected via a complex of subterranean tunnels. A massive cistern is also part of the plan of the city. Each of these churches is an amazing feat of masonry and engineering. They are hewn out of solid rock with no fitted pieces or forms. Each church resembles a cross-shaped building that is set in a pit of solid rock, and the church itself is solid rock. The city of Lalibela does have a long history that may be of great interest to the Roman Catholic Church. Through history, there have been persistent rumors that the Ark of the Covenant was once brought to Ethiopia. It is indeed backed up by narratives from the Bible. This curiosity may have led the Knights Templar, or some of them, to travel to Lalibela in Axum, Ethiopia, at a time when the Templars were still part of the Catholic Church, prior to the schism that occurred between the Templars and the Church in the early 14th century, or early 1300s. The fact that there's a legend of the Ark being here lends credence to the theory that the Templars came in search of it. Okay, other compelling evidence linking the Vatican to the Ark of the Covenant mystery involves the opposite direction of the southeast Windrose marker. So if we follow the northwest Windrose marker, we find that it leads right to Chartres Cathedral in France. And the association here is that there's sculptures and statuary there of the Queen of the Sheba, of Queen of Sheba taking the Ark to Ethiopia. So if you create an azimuth using the Northwest Windrose marker at the Vatican, it leads right to Chartres Cathedral. The Northwest azimuth is the opposite to the Southeast azimuth that leads to Ethiopia in the said location of the Ark of the Covenant. Chartres fits into the Ark of the Covenant mystery in that some of the carvings on the church's north exterior depict the biblical scene of the Queen of Sheba taking the Ark to Ethiopia. Now here's a spatially related clue to the mystery. The later, the builders of Chartres must have been aware of the Ark's location in Ethiopia, and in fact the Chartres Cathedral and the churches in Lalibela, remember, that were supposed to be emulating the layout of Jerusalem, with possibly the Church of St. George representing the Temple Mount, was built nearly at the same time span. I think Chartres was built just a few years later. So there's lots of lore and lots of connecting the dots going on, but somebody was creating an alternate place to go besides the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, possibly for political reasons and that the Muslims controlled it at that time. So just more evidence. So the spatial relationship between the obelisk at the center of St. Peter's and the Windrose markers, specifically the southeast one and the northwest one here, really what creates on the globe is a straight line that goes from Chartres Cathedral, transecting St. Peter's Square over the northwest Windrose marker and the southeast Windrose marker, and continuing to Lalibela, right to the vicinity of St. George Church in Lalibela. Again, Lalibela built to resemble Jerusalem. So this is an interesting spatial relationship, all thematically linked to the Ark of the Covenant. Now, does this mean that the Ark could have been moved to Chartres? I mean, the fact that there are sculptures that are depicting its movement to Ethiopia does not suggest that, but they did take the time to build that cathedral in alignment with Lalibela via the Vatican. And this was still, Chartres was built at a time when the Knights Templar were part of the Catholic Church. So the fact that they may have quested in Ethiopia for the Ark of the Covenant makes sense. These carvings in Chartres, there's lots of mystery said to be deciphered in the sculptures of Chartres Cathedral. Also interesting at Chartres is the labyrinth at Chartres. And that links to another movie I made about Chico, California, where they're in the process of preparing to build a labyrinth on an alignment there that is a copy of the labyrinth at Chartres. And so that's interesting too. That's a valued thing. People like to go to Chartres and walk the labyrinth. Some consider it a stargate or heaven's gate, or somewhere where you go to meditate as you're walking a certain pattern. So it doesn't seem like a bad thing. Prior to the destruction of King Solomon's temple, Menelik, was eventually entrusted with the Ark of the Covenant and fled with it, first possibly to Petra, Jordan, then to Marib, Yemen, and finally to Axum, Ethiopia. At this point in history, Yemen and Ethiopia, which are separated by the Red Sea, were part of the same empire, which was controlled by Menelik I. The fact that the Ark may have once been located in Marib is of interest from a geomantic perspective due to its orientation with the southeast pointing line created by the southeast facet of the Great Pyramid of Giza. So the Great Pyramid of Giza points a line that goes through Mecca and then to Marib, where the Ark of the Covenant once was supposed to have been, and could possibly still be in Marib. There is a mystery here, and they usually just don't tell you, and everything does point to Ethiopia, so maybe it's a hidden place where they're trying to fool you that it's there, or it's actually there, equally as possible, or it's hidden somewhere else and you're supposed to look in Axum. So there's still a mystery, even though the geomancy points you here. Today, the Ark is said to rest in the Church of Our Lady Mary of Zion in Axum, which no one else is allowed in except the one priest who stays there for life. So no one can see it or go in the building where it is, the church where it is, Our Lady Mary of Zion. Okay, so what we'll do is go to the Dome of the Rock, and the south, the way the building points to the south, first passes over Petra, Jordan. The south trending line that would match the, both the east and west facet of the octagon at the Dome of the Rock, then passes over Axum, Ethiopia, where the Ark of the Covenant is supposed to be. Now the same line then proceeds to the south to intersect with the 133.6 degree bearing line that came from the Vatican's at Lalibela. So Lalibela actually represents an intersection of a line that the Vatican points to using the windrose markers and obelisk, and one of the facets of the Dome of the Rock points there as it crosses over Petra and Axum. I mean, this definitely may compel one to believe that Axum and Lalibela were placed in ancient times due to these orientations and as clues to lead you to the Ark of the Covenant. I mean, this is a city that's built as a replica of Jerusalem with an arrangement of amazing architecture, all related to the octagon of the Dome of the Rock and then later pointed to by the Vatican. So another possible resting place of the Ark and other legends have it in Petra. So it's interesting that the line crosses over Petra, Jordan also. I mean, so just the line from the octagon that goes the way it points to the south, Petra, Axum, and Lalibela, all places that have legends of the Ark of the Covenant being there, being stored there, all in alignment with each other that align with the direction suggested by the orientation of the octagonal structure of the Dome of the Rock. And then remember, Marib, another supposed location, lines up with a facet of the Great Pyramid of Giza. So here, that's what's going on. The buildings are pointing you to places. I mean, an interesting side note that ties in with that is that the Queen of Sheba was said to practice a form of sun worship that resembled the monotheistic faith created by Pharaoh Akhenaten earlier in Egyptian history. And also, she has this involvement with the Ark of the Covenant. So this is very interesting material that may be a mystery from the Bible. I mean, many of the directions infer by the angles the pyramid points to point to places where people emulated their faith and architecture and everything else. So that's what we may be looking at with the Dome of the Rock also, and St. Peter's. So that's one of the themes that these more major geomantic hubs may represent that. I mean, here we have a geomantic system that reflects the Odyssey of the Ark of the Covenant after the destruction of King Solomon's temple. They're telling you where it went, and there's a map, and the people that did it adhered to this. I mean, first the Ark, prior to the destruction of the temple, you would think they might hide it because of the approaching armies or the knowledge that they may lose. But maybe Menelik traveled to Petra with it first and waited to see the results of the siege of Jerusalem. And seeing that the defeat had occurred, he could just go southerly along the coast of Arabia, the Arabian Peninsula, till he found his way to Marib, where his mother had already established a city years earlier. It was her home and capital, so he may not have been a stranger to Marib. After that, it would have made its way across the Red Sea to Ethiopia, which, remember, was part of the same kingdom at this point. It spanned the Red Sea. There's some definite logic to the legends of the Ark being here and the geomantic relationship between the Dome of the Rock and Axum may be evidence. The fact that Lalibela aligns with the Vatican would also lend credence to this theory. Remember, Lalibela represents a point where two angles, one from the Vatican and one from the Dome of the Rock, meet each other. And again, there's a replica of the city of Jerusalem and the Temple Mount built there, according to the man who built it. This is what he was trying to accomplish. So that's kind of amazing. And really, if you look at even later history, there's clues as to the importance of Ethiopia here and that this geomancy may be pertinent and have a lot more to do with things than we would ever suspect, because during World War II, the Vatican had a pact of cooperation with the Axis powers of Germany, Italy, and Japan. I mean, they weren't necessarily allied with them. The Vatican is in Europe. They would have to get along with the people who occupied Europe, but a lot of people turn that into something ugly, but we're not sure. Even though they did have a pact of cooperation. So during the war, one of the places that Italy chose to invade was, as a coincidence, Ethiopia. And this is where you connect the dots or read between the lines and see that it's entirely possible that they came to recover what they felt was the real lost Ark of the Covenant. The association between the so-called Axis powers and the Axis Mundi of the Vatican may not be a coincidence, so that's an interesting connection and imagery there. It's possible that the Knights Templar did quest to Ethiopia in search of the Lost Ark. This really makes sense when you look into the value it seems to have to other groups. I mean, there's legends of them in Ethiopia coming to Axum and Lalibela that are very common and part of Ethiopian history and the history of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. And there are graves in Axum that include inscribed Templar crosses that date to the 12th and 13th century. And in fact, that design is a common motif used in the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, and no one's sure whether it came from the Templars or they were already using it when the Templars came, but it seems like a strong chance. It's a definite interesting symbol that the Templars used and now is part of the Ethiopian Orthodox symbology. The tale of the marriage of the Queen of Sheba and King Solomon is included in the Old Testament. If the Templars were indeed in search of relics at the Temple Mount, they may have heard of or found evidence of the Ark's location in the lands once ruled by Menelik I, son of King Solomon. One can also imagine a quest such as this leading the order to hide their own secrets in such a manner, as I said before. So that's an interesting view of really what Graham Hancock has a book called The Sign and the Seal that's about the Lost Ark of the Covenant in Ethiopia, which I have not read completely. I'm relatively sure he hasn't covered any of the geomantic properties that I pointed out here, but he's a great author, and read that book for more on that subject. And there's also a lot of good documentaries on the internet about the churches at Lalibela, and lots of good pictures of that. So everybody have a look at those, because it's really interesting how they just basically excavated a pit and excavated out the building too as they were digging down into the pit. These things are about three stories high in some cases, and really interesting how they're connected by this labyrinth of tunnels and stuff. That seems to be a tradition in the ancient world. All the temple mounts, and their temple mount in Jerusalem is said to have that, and at Baalbek also, and all of the pyramid complexes in Egypt are said to have labyrinths hidden beneath them. So thanks a lot for joining me. That's going to about cover it for the Knights Templar in Ethiopia. And I know it sounds crazy at first, but there's a lot there. And even in the Bible, it describes how the Ark may have been taken away, and there hints that it was King Solomon's son or the Queen of Sheba that ended up with the Ark of the Covenant. So the Templars must have read this, and maybe possibly not finding it at the Temple Mount, figured out the directional information they had and headed to Lalibela and Axum to look for the Lost Ark of the Covenant. All right, thanks for joining me here on Geomantic Information Systems, Grail Quest Radio. I guess I should pick one name or another. But thanks for joining me. Everybody have a great evening out there. Take care.